Let's call this meeting to order. Too much fun. All right, wait till they shut down.
We're gonna have to meet 15 minutes early.
First item on the agenda is citizen comment.
He needs it.
Thank you.
There you go. They're just bringing the hammer down.
Sergeant at arms has spoken. Be quiet. Next agenda item is citizen comments for items that are not on the agenda. Does anyone want to speak to this group? Seeing none, we'll move on to items 3 and 4, which are event permit applications. Is there any discussion on West Haven 5K or the Franklin Cowboys Homecoming Parade? Seeing none, we'll move on to number 5, consideration of the request for sanitary sewer availability for 9330 Clovercroft Road. Is there anyone here to speak to that?
This is the one we've been holding for.
Yeah. Is there anything new on it that we need to bring up at all?
The person making the request.
The third time, I think.
Still didn't show. I think we need to drop this if it's.
Let's move on from this item at this point, and we'll make sure that this resident's happy.
Well, can I ask one question? Did we ever get staff to estimate what their cost would be for this, for the lines and so forth?
Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure. We'll have to revisit it. We don't have the staff person here who's worked this item. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I can't answer that one. So.
And the answer is.
Come on down, Eric.
Eric, do you have anything new on Clovercroft sewer availability?
No. The property owner contacted me, and I asked if they could contact you guys, and I said that would be fine. I directed them to the website where they could get everybody's email.
I
guess they
haven't
talked to anybody.
Wonderful. We'll move on. Next is
a question. Mike did have a question, sorry, sure. About the cost of extending the line.
On what the cost for the line
I told them
be.
That, you know, this wouldn't be a cheap thing, but I told them that, you know, they'd have to pay our tap fees, which are about $4,000, and that they'd have to run a line from their septic over to where the city's line is, and they'd have to hire a plumber to do it. So, and
how many feet are we talking for that line?
It was several hundred feet, I think. I think it was close to 1,000 feet, yes.
So do they realize what their investment is going to be in this?
I never got any indication. I just told them that it would be a costly thing, and I don't know if they ever.
Well, yeah. First of all, were they interested in being annexed?
That's why they wanted to talk to you guys.
Wanted to talk about being annexed?
No, they said they wanted to talk to us about
And that. Since they are not here and have not shown an interest to be here.
We'll move on to item 6 then.
Okay. Here's the deal though. If they call us back up, they can bring it back before us. They may be out of town. Something may have come up. So I think we just ought to hear them if they call us back.
Absolutely. We will. Presentation on Integrated Water Resource Plan Technical Analysis Wrap-Up. CDM and Force. Wonderful.
This is your last installment.
Four
of the mini series.
Yeah. This is the cliffhanger is on this one.
As you said, this is sort of the fourth installment of these sort of close to monthly meetings we've been doing. On different aspects of the Integrated Water Resource Plan to sort of give you an update. Tonight, primarily, we're going to be discussing the water quality model we've done of the Harpeth River, as well as an update on some of the Stella modeling aspects as well. This is sort of the two pieces that tie all the other technical pieces together. So with me tonight is Kurt Westfall and Jimmy Lefkowitz that y'all probably remember from past times. They primarily are handling these two pieces, so they'll be doing a lot of discussions tonight. You should have a copy of sort of, just because there's a lot of technical, a lot of graphical aspects they're going to be discussing, and we want to give you all a handout. As usual, I'll email a electronic copy of the presentation to all of you tomorrow as well.
You guys have.
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Yeah, no, I wanted to make sure they have.
Just generally, real quickly, we did want to, the mayor and Eric had asked us to just briefly touch on the, real quickly, about some fluoridation stuff. I know there's probably been some questions by y'all as a board over the last couple months, as places around here have been discussing that same topic. So we'll touch on that just real quickly, and then we'll go into some of the water quality modeling and Stella modeling. So this first slide, and we'd be glad to provide you more explicit data on this, but just wanted to go through a little bit of the background of some of the recent news on fluoride. It has become a bigger issue over the past couple of years. A lot of places have looked at the issue of fluoridation in water treatment plants, particularly as the economy has turned, other things, especially when you get into large plants, it can be a decent cost to the overall treatment. You can read all those couple of pieces. I mean, it has been restudied by EPA, but most recently, last month, Harvard did come out with a new study that basically said that there is no major concern of fluoride as a cause of bone cancer or is a major risk of any bone-related issues that is the main concern with the fluoride overdosing. And I think the key thing is if you, the group that we traditionally look at from a water perspective on leadership, from a water standpoint, this is actually NWA's policy on public water supply and fluoridation. Basically that they support all these organizations, which are pretty much all your major health and medical organizations, CDC, your major dental associations, with their continuing support of fluoridation in water. Like I said, we've got some other documentation that we'd be glad to share. We just sort of helped the staff do a little bit of research on the topic, and wanted to share that this evening. I don't know if there's any specific questions. I'm definitely not the super knowledge. Katie may have some additional information if there's any questions you have, but we wanted to just pass this information along.
But you're using, so that's all that we're going to talk about with that, because I'm not interested in talking about it. I'm just interested in the fact that you brought up the recommendations through these organizations, but gave no rebuttal to it for other organizations.
Right. I'm sure there's other organizations
so we're
out there.
Just being presented that they say it's okay, CDC.
I think that was the whole point, to just say what the current recommendations are, and it wasn't to really have a discussion.
No, I'm not.
I think that at some point in time that if there's an interest, that we would have a work session on it and bring in some pros and cons or some opposing opinions. But the bulk of this tonight is really, to finish up this final presentation.
Exactly. And right. I wasn't looking for a discussion on that at all. I was just saying that even though that sheet is up there, that slide is up there, there should have been maybe a slide that says, and there are other conflicting attitudes and studies also. Just
right.
So I just want to say that.
Yeah,
that's all it needs to be said.
And I think the main reason we show that this is sort of the authority from the water, if you talk to water professionals across the U.S., this is sort of their perspective. So with that, I'm going to turn it over a little bit to Kirk and Jamie, let them walk through the modeling efforts that have been going on and as far as the RWRP.
Thanks. We've talked a lot about the different aspects of this plan, the water, the wastewater, the reclaimed water, the stormwater. But one thing we haven't dug into in some detail yet with you is the water quality in the Harpeth River. And as we've talked all along, that is the one unifying resource in this whole integrated plan. And one of the indicators of how effective this plan can be will ultimately be its effect on water quality in the Harpeth River. So we want to talk a little bit tonight about what kinds of questions we want to answer technically and scientifically, the tool we've developed to do that, and how we're going to go about answering those questions. The work we did in phase one, last time we talked to you about the modeling, I was primarily looking at the river in terms of its flows and the pollutant loads that go into the river. What we're looking at now is what happens to those loads, the pollutants, once they're in the river and moving in the river, what kind of effects they can have. So it's important to keep in mind the kinds of questions we're asking here. As we start to compare the alternatives, and Jamie will talk in a little while about what the alternatives were developed in phase one, we're going to look at what of the alternatives is likeliest to meet water quality standards or likeliest to provide the best improvement in water quality. Which ones might potentially degrade water quality? What are those effects? Are they big effects? Are they small effects? Are they negligible? Or are they measurable? That type of question. We're not looking at doing a new study on load allocations in the river. That's been done. That's going through permitting processes. But we're looking to compare these different alternatives for the IRP and ask which ones are likely to actually benefit the water quality in the harbor. So we're going to talk a little bit tonight about the water quality upstream of Franklin, what that looks like, and the water quality downstream of Franklin, what that looks like, and what happens within Franklin that can affect that, and how now we have a tool to analyze this and look at these questions. We'll also ask the question, what happens if the water quality upstream of Franklin is improved? How does that affect the decisions that you might make on this integrated plan? The first thing I wanted to do is sort of give ourselves some footing and talk a little bit about the terminology we'll be using. The primary indicator of water quality, and this is sort of mandated by the state in the form of water quality standards and regulations, which are monitored and regulated, is dissolved oxygen. Fish need to breathe just like we need to breathe. And you can measure the amount of oxygen in the water. And there are certain thresholds that it shouldn't cross. Water quality would be considered impaired. There are three primary things that influence water quality in a negative way. And we'll be talking about each of those tonight. One is called biochemical oxygen demand, or BOD. And this is the type of thing that you can get from leaves falling off trees and settling to the bottom of the river and decaying. It's the kind of thing that can originate from, we've got a picture here of cows in stream and their waste decaying and degrading and consuming oxygen as it does that. This is something that depletes the oxygen supply in the river. It's something that we measure carefully and then simulate carefully. Sediment in the river is also another important factor in considering the oxygen in the water column. What happens when leaves settle, what happens when algae settles out, any organic material settles out, it starts to decompose, decay, and that draws oxygen out of the water column too. And it's often an overlooked feature of water quality performance in a river, but it can often be a dominant characteristic of a river in determining how much oxygen there is for the aquatic life. The other is nutrients. That may be a little bit more familiar. You're familiar with nutrients. They originate from treatment plants. They originate from fields. They originate from, again, leaves, anything organic that deteriorates, from fertilizer on lawn. And once it gets washed into the water, it grows into algae. And algae breathes, it consumes oxygen, and it also grows. And as it grows, it takes energy from the sun and converts it into oxygen. So there's a trade-off there. It produces oxygen and it depletes oxygen. And it can do that in different ratios at different times of year. So without getting into too much detail on that, those are the three primary ways that oxygen levels in the river can be influenced. And we're going to talk about how that is affected by the kinds of decisions that you'll be making in the IRP. Now, the one beneficial way that you can affect oxygen is by re-aerating the water. As it flows and churns and so forth, air is mixed with the water. It churns and it can be re-aerated. So a river that has low dissolved oxygen can be improved simply by churning it, by flowing it faster, running it over rocks and that sort of thing. It reintroduces oxygen into the water column. So with those concepts in mind, we'll get into a little bit more detail. And I don't want to dwell on the mechanics of the computer model that we've developed too much, other than to say that it's very different from what we have been talking to you about with the integrated model. And Jamie's going to go back and talk a little bit about the integrated model that looks at all of the water supply, all of the wastewater and stormwater and so forth. The water quality model, which is on the right, looks at the dynamics of the nutrients in the river as they grow into algae, as they decay, as they settle. It also looks at the sediment, which consumes oxygen as it decays. And it also looks at attached algae, which is algae that grows onto the rocks and logs and so forth at the bottom of the river. That also consumes oxygen and provides oxygen at times. So those three primary functions are all simulated in this tool that we'll be talking about. And one of the interesting questions is, what are the dominant forces? which ones prevail and which ones are less important in this Harpeth River. You can never tell just by looking at a river. You need to go through this kind of analysis. When we embarked on this phase of the project, we knew we were going to have to answer a lot of questions about the water quality and how the decisions that you make regarding wastewater treatment plant, water treatment plant, stormwater reuse, all of those integrated decisions that you'll be making will affect the water quality. And there were two tools that were already developed to analyze that. One was used for the TMDL study back in the early 2000s. It was developed by EPA. Another was developed by Tennessee Valley Authority and TDEC. And we compared these two models. They were both already developed for the Harpeth River. We compared them in terms of how well they reproduce the hydraulics of the river, and that's the flow of water, the velocity of the water, the depth of the water, because the only way we can predict water quality is with a good understanding of the flow. The flow is very important in recreating the conditions that either deplete or improve water quality. So we wanted to choose a simulation tool that had good representation of the hydraulics of the river. That includes the dam at the water supply plant, and it includes the channel going downstream for many, many miles through Franklin and downstream. The other things we looked at are the ability to reproduce dissolved oxygen. And that happens both on a daily basis because the levels of oxygen change every day. As you get more light, more heat, the growth goes up, oxygen goes up. And at night, when you have no light, it's just breathing. All the organic material is breathing and consuming oxygen. We needed to be able to represent that. We also needed to be able to represent seasonally the dip in oxygen during the summer when there's more growth because higher temperatures prevail and when more nutrients are being washed into the water from fields and farms and that sort of thing. So we looked at two models, these two models, and really determined that the tool that was used for the TMDL was less appropriate than the tool developed by TVA and TDEC. The TDEC tool not only provided better flow representation in the river, the ability to take a flow from the in-stream and translate it downstream in the right time and at the right flow levels, it also provided a better representation of the oxygen, and that's again both the daily fluctuation and the seasonal patterns. And you can see that on the graph here. The red and black graph is a very quick snapshot of how well the TVA model represents dissolved oxygen. The black is some measured data on dissolved oxygen in Harpeth. The red is the model predictions of that. The other sort of inlay graph there is the TMDL model, which does not do as good a job in that same period of representing these dynamics, which are important. So for a variety of reasons, we chose a model with the help of the steering committee for this project, with the help of Gene LaBeouf, who's on the steering committee, and with the help of TDEC themselves to choose the right model for this study. So I want to begin with what we learned, because this, I think, is fairly interesting. And then we'll get into how we learned it. Three very important, I think, findings in our work to date, calibrating the model and getting it to reproduce historic trends, suggest that the river is already impaired by the time it reaches Franklin. And we'll show you some graphs about that. It's very clear. We've got data sources from Franklin itself, from TDEC, from the Harpeth River Watershed Association, that show that we've got some problems in the river before it even reaches Franklin. The river in Franklin and downstream is really dominated by sediment impacts. And by that I mean the oxygen-consuming decay of what falls out to the bottom of the river. As organic material flows, it drops out, it settles out, and it starts to decay and consume that oxygen. That, we have found, is the dominant source of oxygen depletion in the Harpeth River. And because of that, the changes to the wastewater treatment plant and the changes that you'll be impacting with this IWRP are not as likely to have as pronounced an impact on dissolved oxygen as one might think. This river is really dominated by what's already there, what's coming in from upstream. There's a lot of water quality impairment upstream that won't be affected by the decisions that you'll be making to much of a degree. And we'll show you a little bit about that relativity as we go on. We've simulated some changes to the treatment plant. We've simulated changes to the sediment. And we'll show you how there are things that are within your control and things that aren't as we make these decisions in the IRP. So with that sort of as an understanding, we'll talk a little bit about how we set this model up to answer the questions. It was a collaborative process. We've met with TDEC, the people who developed this tool. They helped us identify the most sensitive parameters. They helped us parameterize this. We met with the Harpeth River Watershed Association to collect data that they have on the river, to get their input on the model and what it should be doing. Again, to answer questions that are relevant to this integrated plan, not necessarily to water quality compliance. That requires some more detail. We've had regular meetings with the steering committee, and that includes Dr. LaBeouf Vanderbilt, who's a water quality expert, to help us calibrate this model, choose the model, and get it working to the point where it can answer the questions that we need to answer. We've also had technical review internally at CDM, and we met this morning with TDEC to review the calibration of the model, and that all has gone very well. The feedback we've gotten is that the simulation tool that we have now is a good representation of the river and all of its dynamics. The data that we've used has come from all over the place. We've gotten data from the USGS. There are two stream gauges in Franklin. This is extremely fortunate. Usually when we do a study like this, the next nearest stream gauge is five counties over, and we've got to do a lot of math to figure out how that translates. We're very fortunate to have two stream gauges of a long record right here in Franklin, and we've used that data as much as we can. We've also got a lot of river channel geometry from TDEC, from FEMA. Again, this information is important to make sure that the water stays in the river for the right amount of time, and it travels over the right amount of time. Without that, you simply can't simulate water quality accurately, because decay takes time, and you have to simulate that balance with the time of the water flow. We don't have data on everything, and so where we don't have data, what we've done is try to do some research on rivers of this type, and we've talked with a lot of experts. We ourselves have a lot of information on what these rivers do, what their sediments do, and so we've been able to apply some very knowledgeable predictions and estimates of the rates at which the sediment decays, the rates at which the algae breathes and dies, and that sort of thing. So where we don't have data, we've been able to apply some very intelligent results or estimates for these dynamics. The sediment effects, again, we indicated that this is one of the dominant factors in this river, but there's not a lot of data on it. And so to make that conclusion defensible, we took the sediment out, and we took the algae that grows on the bottom of the river out. And we tried to reproduce historical observations with everything else in the water column. And we got as far as we could. And we knew that the rest of what we were seeing in terms of oxygen depletion had to be coming from the sediment, because that's all that's left. And that was a very substantial portion of the oxygen depletion in the Harpeth. Let's start looking at some of the data real quick. These two graphs are going to be rather telling, I think. This is dissolved oxygen upstream of Franklin. And this is data that was taken by the city from 2007 to 2010 on a biweekly basis, generally. And it shows the red line there is a state water quality standard for dissolved oxygen. Once you get below that, the water is considered to be impaired. And you can see that even upstream of Franklin, this is, we use some nomenclature that talks about river miles. River mile 99.6 is just about a mile and a half upstream of, about 10 miles upstream of Franklin, the water treatment plant and the withdrawal. But we've got data 2 miles upstream, 5 miles upstream, 10 miles. It all tells the same story. We've got data that's collected by TDEC, by Franklin, on an annual basis, and you know, hundreds of data points on a daily basis. It all tells the same story. The water quality in the summer as it comes into Franklin is already impaired. And that's an important thing to remember. So let's look downstream of Franklin. That's this next graph, with the two lines through it. The blue line here is the water quality about 8 miles downstream of the wastewater treatment plant discharge.
You mean that's upstream?
Which one are you looking at? I'm sorry.
That one's upstream. Mm-hmm.
But this says upstream too.
It is both. It is both. The black points that you see on the second one are still the upstream. Still the upstream. So same as the other. Okay. What we're doing is just overlaying, and if you look at the screen here, you can see what we're doing is taking that upstream data and then overlaying some downstream data on top of it. The blue line is approximately 8 miles downstream of the wastewater treatment plant discharge, and you can see that it doesn't look very different from the water quality upstream of Franklin. Okay? That's interesting. And again, that reinforces our conclusion that this river is dominated by sediment and not necessarily point sources from Franklin. The sediment is going to have that pronounced effect of drawing down that oxygen everywhere in the river, upstream and downstream, regardless of what happens in the city. Now, there are going to be impacts in the city, both positive and negative. The green line here is in between the water treatment plant and the wastewater plant. And what happens there, you'll notice that the green line is a little bit higher than the blue line in the summer. It's a little bit higher than what comes in upstream. What that represents is most likely the re-aeration going over the dam and the treatment plant. That provides some more oxygen into the water. So there's some benefits to having all these things. Likewise, the wastewater plant, it'll be introducing some pollutant loads, but it also introduces more flow. It also introduces, during extreme low flow, some well-oxygenated water. So all of these point sources, all of these localized effects in the city of Franklin have both positive and negative effects that the model will be simulating and accounting for. But far and away, the most important thing that we're seeing in terms of influencing the water quality in the river is the sediment. And that's not something you have a lot of control over. That's something that comes in from upstream and settles out. It's trees falling on the river and letting their leaves settle out and decay. Not a lot can be done about sediment in the short term without a very comprehensive watershed management plan that includes the entire watershed upstream in Franklin and downstream. So some interesting, I think, points of reference as we go through this reinforces the fact that we're really seeing the dominant effects from sediment and not so much from the treatment plants and the point sources of Franklin. So that is background. We'll show you a little bit about what the model does. Now, that was looking at actual measured data. What we're trying to do is we calibrate the model. Basically, when we're calibrating it, we're trying to get the simulation model to produce historical observations. We're trying to get the rates right, the mathematical coefficients right, to simulate the water quality dynamics in the way that they actually happened. What we're not trying to do is determine compliance, as I've said. We are also not trying to match the observations at every single river mile. There's simply not enough data on the sort of the variability in sediment effects from upstream to downstream to do that. What we are trying to do is reproduce all of the general observations that we have, and there are a lot, from all the data sources that we have, in the seasonal patterns of dissolved oxygen. You know, what is it in winter? How far does it drop down in the summer? That sort of thing. That's really important because we can look at that and now look at all of the alternatives in the IRP and say, is that affected? If you build a new treatment plant, does that bring that dissolved oxygen up or down? What does it do? We're also trying to match the diurnal fluctuation, the daily variability in dissolved oxygen, which ranges over a wide range. And sometimes it's enough to drop the water quality below its standard for part of the day and above for part of the day. And it's important to be able to capture that variability. So we're trying to do that, but we're not trying to get a perfect fit at every river mile. That would be needed if we were trying to strive for simulating compliance or non-compliance. What we're trying to do is create a platform in which we can say, what if? What if we built a new treatment plant? What if we reduced the effluent concentrations in the treatment plant? What if we changed our stormwater patterns, regulations, implemented some controls there? How would it affect, one, the daily oscillations of oxygen, and two, the seasonal dip that we see? And we'll be able to very clearly see which alternatives are most likely to have major impacts versus minor impacts. The first thing we did to calibrate the model, as I said, is look at the flows, because a water quality analysis is only as good as the flows that move the pollutants through the system. The red line here is what the model has predicted. This is a year of 2002 that went through some significant low flows, as well as some very high flows in the spring and the fall and winter. And what you want to see here is the lines matching up. The black line here is the USGS measured stream flow in the Harpeth River, right near the water treatment plant intake. The red line is what the model predicts for the flow. And so we're looking at the top graph there, right at the upstream boundary of our model, and the bottom graph is at the downstream end of our model. River mile 62, roughly 25 miles downstream of the city of Franklin. Okay, and you can see that over the range of flows, high flow to low flow. The model is doing a good job of reproducing that and transporting the flow from upstream to downstream.
And you said this was a time that was kind of low flow?
Or? Yeah, 2002 had some very low flows. You can see both the measured and the simulated flows got down to about 5 CFS. And 5 CFS in the heart of the river will be subsurface sometime. You won't see that. Mm-hmm. It'll also be a series of pools and riffles and puddles off to the side. It won't be noticeable flow. You won't see water moving when it's down that low. So it's a good year to check the ability of the model to get both the very high flows, the flood flows, as well as the very low flows.
And what was the lowest CFS?
We got down in 2002 to about 5 CFS. 4 or 5 CFS, so it's very low.
So is this kind of an exponential graph?
Yeah, that's an exponential graph. It's a logarithmic graph. And it's sort of an effective way to show both the low flow as well as the high flow without washing
that. That'll be on the whole page.
Yeah. Yeah, we
okay. So is that why the top one looks clipped at the bottom? It looks suspicious.
It's really.
Yeah. Well, there are measurement caps. First of all, with the USGS gauges, they will really, for all of their gauges, they'll qualify it and say below a certain threshold, the flows are just not, the measurements are not credible.
So it's not going to measure.
It's not going to measure.
It could have been lower than that.
It could have been lower than that. It wouldn't measure it.
Okay.
Right. The next graph has a lot of important things. We'll talk about this one for a few minutes. This is the dissolved oxygen performance now in the water quality for the years 2007, 8, and 9. And these are important years because in that sequence they represent fairly dry hydrology, fairly normal hydrology, and then a very wet year. The black dots here are the measured data that Franklin took on dissolved oxygen. The green is our model. And the reason you see so much noise in the green signal, that's the daily fluctuation. That's every day the oxygen is going up and down as the algae grows and breathes. And what we wanted to see here was, does the model drop below certain thresholds at roughly the same frequency that the data do? And the answer is yes. We have done some statistics on that that show that. But more importantly, are we capturing the seasonal trends? You know, are we roughly matching the wintertime DO and the summertime DO? Are we getting down low enough? And are we responsive to changes in hydrology? As we get wetter, we clearly get a lot better, and the model is able to capture that and predict that. We wanted to make sure that these are the 3 years that we'll be using for all of the what-if questions as we do the analysis for the IRP, 2007, 8, and 9, representing the full range of hydrologic conditions. And so we wanted to make sure that the model was able to be, first of all, representing the historical conditions, but also sensitive enough to those changes in hydrology. And you can see a lot more black dots below the threshold in the drier years, far fewer in the wetter years, and the model does the same thing. Very important thing. We'll zoom in now on a couple of areas in 2003 and in 2006. The first graph here on the top shows some wintertime performance. Again, the green here is the model, the black is the data. And there are a couple things I wanted to point out here. Again, we're not after a perfect reproduction of every river mile. This first graph here is at river mile 84.4, is just downstream of the wastewater treatment plant. Again, what we're after is the seasonal variation. We don't show any daily oscillations in the wintertime. We're not getting variations in temperature, in light, so we're not growing anything. And in the summertime, we are. We wanted to make sure we're capturing that. So generally, this is the type of information you look for in a water quality model. And both the winter and the summer are within the range, but they're not perfect. And for the integrated plan, they don't need to be. They need to be enough so that they're sensitive to changes. And we know that as we simulate the what-if questions, these lines will move up and down, and we'll be able to tell which alternatives are really the best in terms of water quality. One thing I wanted to point out as a limitation of the model is that the events that you might see once every 10 or 20 years, very extreme low flow conditions, 1 or 2 CFS for extended periods of time, really can't be modeled hydraulically because, as I said, a lot of that water is subsurface. We're not being able to simulate that mathematically. A lot of it is stagnant pools that kind of hang around the side of the river. We can't simulate that mathematically. And so we don't want to focus on these very short, very infrequent, very low-flow events for our decision-making. What we do want to focus on are the years that include the kinds of low-flow that you'd see on an average basis. That's 2008, what we're calling our normal hydrology. A year that would include flows that get lower than normal, down to, you know, 10.5 CFS in the river. And that's 2007. The model is able to do that. But what it doesn't do is, for a very long time, take flows of 1 or 2 CFS and simulate those accurately. So you see in the lower graph there, the black line, the data drop off a little bit. What that could be is either an extreme low flow, where water is just not moving at all. You're measuring the water the oxygen in a stagnant pool. And we talked with TDIC about that, and they confirmed that's very likely what we're seeing there. So we're not trying to match that kind of dip. Again, we're trying to create the ability to relatively understand which alternatives will move this dissolved oxygen line up or down as a whole.
Just one question.
Sure.
So you did 2002, 2003, mm-hmm. 2006, 7, 8, and 9. But was there any reason just to be jumping? I see what you already did on the 3. That was the low, normal, and mm-hmm. half flow, yeah. But...
There are two reasons for that. The first reason is that for those are the years that we had the most amount of data. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted to capitalize on all of that data from Franklin, from TDEC, from Harpeth River Watershed Association, to use that data to the greatest extent we could. The second reason is when you calibrate a model, you're tuning it to reproduce what has happened historically. That was the 2002, 3, and 6. Okay. The years in which we want to do the what-if questions want to be independent of that. So the graph that you see of all 3 years together, this one, oops, is after the calibration was done. And we wanted to show that now that it's been tuned, mm-hmm. We haven't tuned it just to these conditions, but you know, by golly, it works for these conditions right. too. Mm-hmm. And so we call that the validation of the model. And now these are the years that we'll be doing the what-if questions. And you generally want those to be independent of the calibration so that the performance during those years is not unduly influenced by the setting of one parameter to match a certain point or trend. Sure. I want to show you some data that we have in 2006. This was collected by the Harpeth River Watershed Association at River Mile 82, which is just a couple miles downstream of the treatment plant, and at River Mile 66, which is quite a few miles downstream of the treatment plant. And again, this was data that was collected over the course of several days, and you'll see now the daily pattern being matched fairly well in addition to the overall average level in these summertime periods. So between the 3 years that we used to calibrate the model, 02, 03, and 06, we felt very comfortable that we were capturing the seasonal trends and these low summertime trends, both daily and annual. And then we validated that with the 7, 8, and 9 for our analysis. I want to show you a little bit about what we did with this tool. I may be missing a slide here. Oh, it comes up on it. Okay. We did some sensitivity analysis. We haven't started doing the what-ifs for the specific alternatives in the IRP because we wanted to meet with TDEC, with the steering committee, and make sure that this calibration was acceptable. And so far, we've gotten nods of heads that it is. But we did do some sensitivity analysis on the 3 things that I talked about earlier in the river. The wastewater treatment plant, what happens if we change that? We looked at the sediment, what happens if you change that? And we looked at some of the algae, what happens if you change that? This first graph is a change in the treatment plant. And it's not really a physical change. What we're looking at here is looking at the permitted effluent. This is a 12 MGD treatment plant where it is today. So we're looking at really today's conditions. But looking at the permitted effluent concentrations, which are in the blue, and the actual concentrations that you've been discharging, which are in the red. Okay, and you don't see a whole lot of difference. And that is amplified here when we look a little bit closer on a daily scale. On the scale of measuring dissolved oxygen, what we're looking at here is really on the order of measurement error. We're looking at a few decimal places of milligrams per liter. And so that was a fairly significant change to the actual effluent coming out of the treatment plant, and yet it doesn't provide much of an impact to the dissolved oxygen in the river. This was during August of 2007. This is during a low-flow period, so it's when the river is most susceptible to this kind of load coming in. Again, it does two things. Three things, really. It introduces pollutant loads. It also introduces some reoxygenated water, and it also introduces water itself, which increases the flow and the assimilative capacity, the ability to take more pollutants downstream. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of trade-offs there. But what we saw is that the wastewater treatment plant, just in this little analysis, doesn't have much of an impact on the actual dissolved oxygen right there. The next thing we looked at were sediment impacts. In the first graph here, the upper graph, is the fixed algae. It's also called periphyte. This is algae that's not floating in the water but growing on the rocks. And it's always exerting some kind of influence on oxygen. Again, it breathes and it dies. And both of those either increase or decrease the oxygen in the water. And this red line here is a simulation of the river, again, through an entire year without any attached algae growing at all. We just took it out, extracted it from the model. And you can see that what it does is it changes the daily fluctuation. It doesn't really change the overall seasonal sag, but it changes how much the river oscillates daily. And that can have a pronounced effect on compliance, ultimately. It's a good measure of how susceptible the river is. Like huge swings, daily swings, make a river more susceptible. Then we looked at the sediment oxygen demand. This is all the decaying organic matter at the bottom of the river, the muck that really is just sucking the oxygen out of the water. And you can see this has a very different impact. The red here again is we just extracted it. We took all of its impacts out. We just basically, in effect, coated the bottom of the river with a nice clean sheet of plastic, so it couldn't do anything. And you see that the average dissolved oxygen goes up substantially. And then when we include it at a very reasonable rate of depletion, it brings it down on the order of 2 milligrams per liter. And when you've got a river that's already non-compliant upstream, 1 to 2 milligrams per liter impact is a big deal. And these three things, the effects of the wastewater plant, the attached algae, and the sediment, are telling us now what drives the oxygen in this river fairly clearly. The sediment, the attached algae are what's driving it. And it makes sense because this is a wide river. It's flowing slowly and shallow. And so everything on the bottom has a chance to act on that entire area, all that water, a lot of the time. It's very different in rivers that are deep mm-hmm. and fast flowing because the water doesn't stay over a given area for very long. But when it does, all of that sediment has a chance to pull the oxygen out. So it actually makes a lot of sense for this river. Just some considerations and some things to keep in mind as a way of rehashing. Again, upstream of Franklin, we've already seen impairment in dissolved oxygen. TDEC has acknowledged that a lot of the gauges that were used to collect dissolved oxygen data have not been completely reliable during low flow. They're not necessarily in the most effective places in the river. Ideally, you'd want it right in the middle of the stream, but sometimes there's no place to fix a gauge there, and so they're more on the side. And so again, we don't want to put a lot of emphasis on these very, very low flow events and try to match those specifically, both for model limitations and because of the actual credibility of that data. In terms of the model limitations, what we do and don't want to use it for, again, the extreme low flow conditions, we really can't simulate subsurface flow or a series of puddles that aren't flowing at all. And so we want to concentrate on flows really above 5 CFS, 10 CFS, and higher. One thing that's a consideration is that one of the things we want to do is look at the impacts of changing the water quality upstream. How might that change the way you make your decisions on this IRP? And there's an important physical linkage between what comes in upstream and what the sediment does downstream. As you introduce organic material upstream, it flows and settles out in Franklin downstream. That's obviously a physical cause and effect relationship. That's not simulated explicitly in the model. So we need to be careful about setting up scenarios that represent what actually happens there.
How are you going to keep the leaves from falling? You know, how are you going to keep the leaves from falling?
Well, you
can't.
Yeah, you can't. And that's why it's important to understand the influence that you can have and the influence that you can't have. Yeah. There's no way to prevent some of these things from happening. It will happen.
Thank you, Mayor.
No, that didn't come from me.
Dr. LaBeouf pointed out that there are some specific reaches in the river that are more susceptible to algae blooms than others, specifically when some tributaries downstream come in. We don't have a lot of data on the water quality and the tributaries in the Harpeth. We've got a tremendous amount in the Harpeth itself, not a lot on the tributaries. And so we're focusing really from just upstream of Franklin to about 20 miles downstream. There is continued impairment downstream of that. We believe that a lot of that is influenced by the tributaries, but we don't have a lot of data to prove that one way or the other. So we need to be careful about how we use those results. And so what do we do next? And then I'll turn it over to Jamie to talk a little bit about how we're going to do that. We now have a tool that has been reviewed internally at CDM by the steering committee, by TDEC, and the general consensus is it's ready to start using for answering what-if questions. What if we built a new treatment plant? What if we took more or less water out of the Harpeth River? What if we changed our stormwater regulations? And we'll be able to get some answers. What happens to the river water quality? And these then can directly influence the decisions that you make as part of the integrated plan. We do want, we developed four alternatives in phase one. They may morph a little bit as we move forward, but we want to answer the question, which of those four has the best impact in your water quality? It may not be the most cost-effective, it may not be the most reliable, but we are interested in knowing which one yields the best water quality. And then again, which ones are likely to yield the best water quality if the water quality upstream of Franklin that you don't have any control over is improved so that it does meet water quality standards. Those are the questions that we're going to start to address now.
And will you be looking at the DO levels, how that might be affected once the Lowhead Dam is taken out? Because the water withdrawal that we do with the Lowhead Dam affects those levels.
Mm-hmm. And that is included in one of the alternatives, maybe more than one of the alternatives. And so we will be simulating that. The model does that. It has specific re-aeration rates that happen at the dam that will be changed. And it also has oxygen depleting effects upstream of the dam that will be changed. The water is impounded, and so the sediment has even more time to act on it. So there's that trade-off. There's sort of a benefit and a disadvantage, and we'll be studying that as part of the alternatives analysis.
Because I would think, too, the initial effect, which I think long-term effect will be good, but the initial effect will be releasing sediment and all the things that will come with that over a period of who knows how much time that will be.
Right. Sometimes dam removal projects like this for low-head dams include removal of some of the top layers of sediment first, and sometimes they don't. And when they don't, yes, it does get washed downstream. But again, that may even be not so bad. If it's toxic, you've got some concerns. I don't believe that's the concern here. It's more the oxygen demand. And the oxygen demand, right, and I don't think that's an issue here. The oxygen demand may just be redistributed, and it may not be that detrimental to you. We won't have the ability to simulate how that sediment moves in the model. There are specific tools that can do that, much more advanced than what we've developed here for specifically for sediment interactions and movement and mobility in streams.
But isn't that a significant factor in this? If you're saying bottom sediment is the biggest factor, but you can't model hydrology on how it might move it if the dam is removed.
But we know enough about how that can happen. And we also know enough that because there aren't toxic concerns, All we're really doing is taking what's consuming oxygen upstream of the dam and moving that to what's consuming oxygen downstream, and it's the same thing. It comes from the same sources. And so over the long term, that will all stabilize based on what happens upstream in the watershed. All of the sediment demand is a function of what happens upstream and the loads coming in, from the leaves to the effluent and so forth. And we can make some fairly scientific and credible assumptions about how that can happen, both in the near term and the long term.
But again, isn't this significant? If water is impounded by the dam, so there's a certain amount of sediment buildup there. Mm-hmm. If you remove the dam, how does that affect speed of the river, removal of sediment through seasonal things?
I think the
when
answer
there's low flow and so forth.
Yeah, the answer to that is that the oxygen depleting substances upstream and downstream are really the same. Come from the same sources. And when you remove the dam, what you're doing is changing the time that the water spends over each of those areas. So upstream of the dam, right now, you get some depletion. Downstream, you get some reaeration, and then it starts to suck the oxygen back out. If the dam were to be gone, you'd see sort of a more uniform impact. But the actual sources of sediment, however they're distributed, are still going to consume oxygen in the same way. It's the time that the water spends over each that governs the actual concentrations in the stream, and then the reaeration over the dam itself that can help benefit downstream.
When the dam is removed, mm-hmm, and work is done on the river, will that sediment be manually removed?
I don't know. I mean, that would be a decision that would have to be part of that project. In some cases, it is. I've seen it is removed, and in some cases, it's not, and it washes downstream. And where it's not, generally, there's a concern about legacy toxics. Where it is removed, there's generally a concern about legacy toxics in there that you don't want to spread downstream. But if it's nutrients that are entering the stream anyway, it's less of a concern.
So in our case, there's less of a chance that we're going to remove the sediment, is that what you're saying, because we're not concerned about toxins?
Purely from a dissolved oxygen standpoint. Okay. There are a lot of other considerations in there.
Do you guys want, this is part of the project you're going to talk about late on a later item, but we can have him speak to that.
Well, the sediment behind the dam is extremely coarse sediment, so it's not...
Yeah, I need to come up. Sit down at the end there.
Hi, I'm Mike Kane with the Harpeth River Watershed Association, and I did a big study with TWRA several years ago, and I think we provided that data for this. The sediment that's behind the Lowhead Dam is a very coarse sediment. I would suggest that its effect on sediment oxygen demand is probably fairly low in relation to what you find in the other parts of the river. One point you did make was about reaeration at the Lowhead Dam. And the fact of the matter is there's minimal reaeration going on in low flow periods. And there is extremely low dissolved oxygen within the impoundment because of the impoundment. So the effects of the dam are probably very minimal. They're probably lowering DO in that section of the river slightly. Now there is a lot of aeration going on at the sewer treatment plant. So any data you see that show slightly elevated levels going through the city of Franklin are more than likely caused by extreme aeration of the effluent before it goes into the river. And you got to realize that you're putting out sometimes as much as 4 million gallons a day into a river that sometimes is not flowing more than 100,000 gallons a day. So, but in terms of taking the dam out and what happened to that sediment, we did look at all the toxic metals, and there were virtually none that we even expected to find. Nothing was really above background levels at all. And the USGS people say that the downstream river segments have actually been robbed of this more coarse sediment that would provide good habitat for bugs and other aquatic creatures. So taking the dam out and letting that sediment move down is probably going to be beneficial to the whole system. The total amount of sediment back there is not that much too. You're talking about 1.7 miles, and we calculated about 33,000 cubic yards. About half of that would be there naturally without, so we're only talking about a fairly small amount of sediment that will begin to travel. So.
Well, can I ask too about the movement of the sediment and the DO, movement of the sediment and the DO levels both? Will they be adversely affected or affected in a positive way depending on what time of the year you remove the dam?
You know, I
is
think
that
the,
not
I
plan
think,
at all?
I think part of the plan would be to take the dam out during low flow season. And I don't think it's going to have much of an effect on dissolved oxygen levels during their low already. And I don't think it's going to make that much of a difference. And I think in general, there'll be some improvement in water quality and dissolved oxygen through the city with the dam coming out.
I would hope so.
It's not going to change everything. It's not going to all of a sudden make you have plenty of dissolved oxygen through the city, but it will make some incremental changes in that particular aspect.
Thank you.
We have seen some aeration that occurs at the dam, just looking at the data, before it gets to the treatment plant. We see it at both locations. We see some aeration at the dam, and we see aeration again at the treatment plant because of the highly aerated effluent. So again, it will be a study in trade-offs. There are a lot of things to consider. And what we're looking at right now are the effects of the sediment, the dam, and the effluent on dissolved oxygen specifically.
Tell us about the Stella model.
So I'll turn it back over to Janie now, and she's going to talk about what we're talking to you more about in phase one. That's the integrated model.
Right. So I can mark this. I've been doing this for the past year a lot, but I realize that you all haven't seen this in a few months, several months. So I'm going to refresh your memory a little bit on what the integrated model is, what came out of phase one, and what we're doing with all the other information that you've been presented over the past few months on the wastewater treatment, the water treatment, distribution system, all of that. We're integrating that back into the model to update it. So to remind you, the integrated model is different than the river water quality model. It's a high-level representation of all of the systems within Franklin. So we have the wastewater system and the water system and how they're all connected, the reclaimed water, how you pull water from the river, how it's used, and how it goes back to the river. It's really just a model of the movement of water throughout Franklin, which is what we call our integrated model, or I'll refer to it as the Stella model. That's the software that we use to do all these calculations. So we're integrating the information from other studies as well as the phase two technical analysis, which has been presented to you over the past few months. And we're doing that to compare trade-offs between the alternatives. If you remember from phase one, we came up with a list of project options and broke those into alternatives. And the integrated model helps us compare trade-offs, so cost and benefit, whether it's dollar cost or water quality cost, just cost-benefit trade-offs. The other handout that you have is a list of all those project options from phase one and how we broke them out into different alternatives with the stakeholder committee in phase one. And we're looking at this, we're refining this and using the model to further study the effects of these different projects on various things within Franklin. So cost, water quality. You may remember this slide from phase one. This is kind of the crux of integrated planning, and this is the why and the how, and the why are objectives and performance measures. So we got together with the stakeholders and came up with a list of objectives for this entire plan, and then decided on performance measures. How do we measure progress towards those objectives? And then using the model to score them. The how, on the other hand, are these options and alternatives. So how do you achieve those objectives in Franklin? How do you design your wastewater plants, your water plants, your management of the water resources within Franklin? And where we're at right now is the blending of the two tracks. The why and the how come together and you evaluate everything using an integrated model, discussion with stakeholders. That's really phase two. Evaluate everything so we can give you the most possible information coming out of the IRP so that you can make a decision. So these are to remind you of those nine objectives that we came up with the stakeholder committee, the steering committee. These are in order of importance. If you remember, they weighted the objectives. They were given 100 points to assign to the various objectives that everyone came up with, and they were weighted accordingly. So going from meeting current and future demands for water, which was the most important objectives of the entire plan, down to improving the water quality, being more efficient with all of the resources within Franklin related to water resources. And also in the list is providing utility services at a reasonable cost. That's higher up there. As you move into five through nine, those were weighted a little bit less. Safety and security, achieving a regional acceptance of this plan so that Franklin can use this to integrate their water resources with other regional aspects, other utilities and the entire watershed as needed. And down to achieving sustainable biosolids management, improving the access and aesthetics of the river, and even reducing the carbon footprint of all water resources processes. So the how is how do, sorry, I lost my place. Here we are. How do we achieve this? And this is back to this table, reminding you from phase one of the different alternatives. But there's, we chose these four alternatives with the stakeholder group through a lot of discussion and preliminary analysis with the integrated model, and chose them because each one has a different key combination of options, of major options, which we consider the most costly options, the wastewater plant, the water plant. So running through those quickly, we have the first one, which is the efficiency plus the safety and security. We gave them names based on what was the major objective of each alternative. So that includes building a new wastewater plant, as well as expanding the current water treatment plant. There's the water quality plus alternative, which was aimed at really doing the most you could to improve the water quality in the river based on the information that we had in phase one. And that does not include a new wastewater plant and does not include any water treatment plant in Franklin. That would, we would get all of the water from Harpeth Valley. So you wouldn't draw water from the river at all. The third alternative to explore further in phase two was the low cost alternative. So we tried to mix these options together to achieve the objectives at the lowest cost, and that also includes no new wastewater plant and minimal extra options. And by extra options, I mean the things towards the bottom of this long list, so ecological restoration or some of the stormwater options, much less costly, but they can have a pretty significant benefit to the river based on which objective you're looking at. And then the fourth was the reliability alternative. And that was kind of putting everything in to make the most robust and reliable system, sometimes maybe too redundant. And that included a new wastewater plant, also upgrades to the existing wastewater plant, and building a big enough water treatment plant so that a raw water line could be built from the Cumberland River to bring water all the way into Franklin so that you wouldn't be relying on anyone else except for your own water line for water. So very redundant, obviously very costly alternative, but we like to keep it in there as kind of the top of the chart for alternatives. So if you'll recall,
that would be the new Porsche, wouldn't it?
Yeah, not even something that you would even want. Maybe something even more ridiculous, like a Lotus or a something Ferrari.
Go back to that. Mm-hmm. Go back to that chart.
Oh, this one?
Yeah, water quality. No, the other one.
Okay.
The one you just.
Yeah.
Water quality plus no new water wastewater treatment plant, mm-hmm. and no water treatment plant. Is there one on there for no new wastewater treatment plant and a water treatment plant?
The low cost.
Three?
Number three would have no, you would just.
No new wastewater treatment plant, but minimal extra costs.
And that's
so the water treatment plant stays in number three.
Yeah, stays the same as it is.
At existing capacity.
At existing capacity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
No improvements?
And you have to do certain improvements to keep it viable.
Yeah.
Right.
But
you maintain the same treatment level. Yeah, right.
And I think the key to Alderman Martin Hill is that like Jamie said, a lot of these were based on our best knowledge guess based on the information we had at the end of phase one. So there may be some changes in this that where we've discovered there may be things that may not truly be the best water quality that we may have to adjust this a little bit as we start evaluating phase two.
Right.
But generally this was how we went through as a group of stakeholders and defined which one of these projects do you think meets these concepts. That's how they sort of laid out.
Mm-hmm. Well, also in number three, Clyde, what you're talking about there, the low cost, no new water treatment plant, but minimal
wastewater treatment plant.
Yeah, wastewater, but upgrades to the one we have now. But that also doesn't include. Just lost my train of thought. Something about the low cost. Forget. I'll come back to it.
Okay. If you think of it,
it was
jump in.
It was a question I was going to ask you about. The minimal options or something. I think that we would
Okay, I'll come back to it, because it had to do with the minimal options on that.
Okay, just jump in if you think of it.
Yeah.
Because we'll stay on this for a little while. So you might remember this plot that we, this was kind of the end of phase one. We ran the model and scored each alternative based on the performance measures, and each performance measure has a value, and then we use a decision tool to normalize those and come up with a score for each alternative. So this still isn't new. This is from phase one. But what we'll be doing in phase two is revising this plot based on all the information that we're getting from those subtasks that are doing much more in-depth studies, revising these alternatives and options, and revising the input to the model to make it more robust, more reliable, and less assumptions. So some of those upgrades and updates that I'm talking about are an updated of unit costs. It's important to have the best possible unit cost in there for gallons or dollars per gallon treated or dollars per gallon pumped, so that you can come up with a cost for each alternative, because that's a very important aspect of it. Also, capital and maintenance costs. When they're actually going through conceptual designs of these plants, they're able to give us better estimates of those costs. Also, unit energy requirements. When you pick a process design, it has different energy requirements than another process, as well as treatment capacities. We're talking a lot with the steering committee about where to send different volumes of water, how much a new water treatment plant might treat based on the configuration of the collection system, as well as we did an inflow and infiltration study, so we have the results of that, and we're integrating that into the analysis to get really good estimates of your INI in the collection system. And you all heard from Dave Mason on the stormwater BMP studies that we've done to really quantify the benefits of these kind of a little bit more abstract stormwater options. In order to analyze them with the model, we really need to quantify the benefits. So the phase two studies have helped us do that, as well as phasing of the capital projects and updates to the wastewater treatment plant effluent concentrations, which has to do with how do you permit a new wastewater plant or an upgrade to your wastewater plant. And you do that through studying the effluent concentrations that you can achieve.
Basically, this is where the information we've sort of went over the last three or four meetings comes in back into the Stella model in a much more exact manner, so we can take what we had, you know, ballpark numbers for in phase one and make them more exact in phase two.
Mm-hmm. So some other updates that we've added, not just improving the information, but actually changing this integrated model. You'll remember kind of it was a high-level view, and we've added some more high-level things to it, and one of those things is a dynamic wastewater plant at the Goose Creek location, or the south potential new wastewater treatment plant location, so that we can evaluate those effects.
Different from the one that we have purchased?
No. This is the same thing. It just wasn't in the phase one model.
Yeah, in phase one, we just had the actual truly operating plant.
We talked about two locations for another wastewater treatment plant, either one south or one adjacent to the present one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the cost, you know, vary. You've either got to pay for the waste to be transferred here to this one or build down here. All right, did we talk about another location for a water treatment plant? Have we talked about another location?
We haven't really evaluated any other option from a water treatment plant standpoint. One sort of issue from a water treatment plant is no matter where you put that plant, unless you were to locate it all the way up in another county and pump it down here, which is sort of what the raw water line, you're still ultimately going to have the same water source, which is going to be the Harpeth. Mm-hmm. So from a what you're tied to from a water treatment plant standpoint, it doesn't matter if you put the plant in one location in the city or another, you still only have so much water within the Harpeth that you could ultimately pull from.
So probably the present location is maybe the best location for it.
Well, I mean, from the
standpoint, because it's adjacent to the river.
Well, and you have
the reservoir.
You have a reservoir there, and you have a treatment plant already there. So anything else would be building a brand new, you know, facility. So, but what the model does allow us to do is look at the option of having a new wastewater, you know, sort of the way we talked about varying where that capacity comes from a wastewater treatment plant standpoint. We can look at it from the Stella model if it's at this location or if it's at this location from a river mile standpoint, because both of those are currently modeled in they actually have an input and an output from that location. So we can see, if you put it here, how does that affect the river water quality, or, you know, and tie that back to the cost we discussed, or if you put it here, how does that affect river water quality, and then evaluate that on the cost and other parameters.
I knew we talked about two locations for that, but I didn't know about.
Really, for water treatment plant, you've got one, you know, it's a balance of how much you treat yourself versus how much you purchase from Arpa Valley.
Question, the cryptosporidium treatment was kind of a fairly new item, you know, that y'all brought in last time.
Right.
Have you plugged that into unit costs per gallon?
Yeah, that will be included both without, with or without, into the overall cost of the water treatment plant project, and how that ultimately ties into the meeting your permit limits as well, so.
Well, that's the thing I was trying to get at before, I was looking at these four points here for alternatives, and I was wondering, when you said efficiency plus safety and security, so, you know, new water, wastewater treatment plant and expand the old one, and I'm thinking to myself, isn't this going to be needed for growth? And then number three, the low cost, no new water treatment plant, the one that we were thinking of putting down various farms.
Wastewater.
You know, WWTB. I'm thinking, is there not going to be a need, like if we're looking at this for the future, what are we saying? Do we not think we're going to need that wastewater treatment plant due to growth? Because, and then if we do, like Margaret said, you know, one of the alternatives is to pump it back up. But if we're going to have the growth down there in the next 20 years, how do we put that in the model? I mean, how do we look at that to say, what is going to be the best choice here?
Well, you go back to look at your objectives, and your number one objective in order of priority is meeting the needs and demand needs of the community, both on a wastewater and water treatment standpoint. My advice is not get too tied up into the four generic alternatives.
We're not there yet. Yeah.
That those really aren't what you're going to be choosing between. Those were ways of looking at what are the combinations that made sense within a certain perspective. Ultimately, we step back and we look at the top priorities and how these larger components fit. So it's not really, you're not really going to choose between 1, 2, 3, and 4. You're going to choose between a broader menu that helps us address the bigger picture needs, and especially look at the demand side of this, as well as the regulatory environment that we know is a reality as well. So that's my perspective.
Yeah, I think this was like a first, you know, 30,000 level. Now we're coming down to a much lower level where we'll reevaluate which one of these really makes sense. And, you know, like Eric said, the titles there really are just things we use to sort of name what those are. We can easily call them 1, 2, 3, 4.
It's a good way to look at the trade-offs that we make as we think about these alternatives, about cost versus meeting capacity and reliability and all of those. So you really are refining it at this
point. Because if you look at number 4, I mean, come on, you know, 99.99%, we cannot go to the Cumberland River.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, cost number 1, and number 2, how are you going to get through from Cumberland to here?
It's a big problem.
It helps bound the problem and understand what works and what doesn't. Exactly. Hopefully, we can take a look at these charts and say, for those 4, what are the projects that make them work? Make them work well, or they don't make them work well.
And then we can start to merge those 2 together.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Remind me what the numbers are on the bottom of that graph.
The scores.
The scoring is the normal scale.
Scoring scale.
Yeah, okay. It's a normalized scale. So
and the key
dollars with water quality.
The key thing to remember there, and we've discussed before, it's not really a max of 1. I mean, even if you did every project on here, there is give and takes with each one of them that ultimately, I can't remember what the exact top score, but it's 0.7 something, 0.7. I believe. So at the best case scenario is 0.7. You can't ever get to 1.
Because there's always a trade-off. There's always a cost associated with the benefit. Okay. So moving quickly through the other updates to the integrated model, another major thing that we're changing is the reclaim demand structure in the model. We've worked with SSR on this too. In phase one, the approach that we took was an if you build it, they will come approach to the reclaim demand. So if we put in the lines, and this is how our model represented the system. If you put in the lines, they'll use the water. But we knew throughout phase one and moving into phase two, that that might not be exactly how it will pan out. And you don't want to rely on using all your wastewater as reclaimed water if your permits are contingent upon that. So we've revised that, and we're using much more realistic reuse demand patterns based on who is ready to connect, where the growth is definitely going to happen. And we've really kind of more than divided those demands in half down to an average demand of 3.4 MGD and a peak of 11.4 in the summer. It's a much more realistic view of the reclaimed demand pattern, we feel, moving forward. The other thing we can do with the model that we've learned from phase two are some of the distribution system improvements that have to do primarily with water age and water quality in the distribution system. I think you heard about that, was it last month? We can look at the trade-offs for doing those projects, and the benefit beyond water quality of your drinking water is that not having to route already treated water through your treatment plant again to meet these requirements. So that'll be a cost savings from an integrated point of view. And lastly, the integrated model will allow you to look at nutrient trading between wastewater and stormwater load. So right now you have two permits. You have a wastewater load permit and you have a stormwater MS4 permit. A possible mechanism for getting a higher waste load from your wastewater treatment plant is to trade that with stormwater. So if you can reduce your stormwater loads to the river, perhaps you can get a higher load from your wastewater plant. And the integrated analysis looks at those together as a total load. So the next steps with the integrated model over the next few months as we lead into the next stakeholder meeting and the finalize this project is to finalize the input from the phase two technical analysis. So you've heard the talks from all the other groups, and there's a little bit more work to be done to finalize those analysis, and then revisit that current formulation of alternatives, which Eric just talked about. So looking at them, do they still make sense? What do we need to switch out? How have the options and alternatives developed throughout phase two? What have we learned, and how can we change that so that it makes the most sense for Franklin now? And then using Stella to refine those alternatives, and then reproducing those performance measures again, recreating those scores so that you can look at it in the same context again. And there'll probably be a different set of four. They'll be similar, but a different set of four alternatives that we'll explain again in another one of these that has the results of phase two analysis in it. And at the end of October, we have another workshop scheduled with the stakeholders to present the results and have discussion, get their feedback, and then a final workshop after that, after we complete the plan, to present the final plan and present it to you as well. So that's the time frame we're looking at with the integrated model.
Yeah, the next stakeholder workshop is October 26th, and I'll be sure to get you all out an invitation for that as well. So. And that'll be to present back out, like Jamie said, this final findings of phase two from a scoring and alternatives perspective to really start discussing where we can make adjustments to that, get feedback from the stakeholder group.
But you bring that report to us, so why would we need to be there?
Well, you don't have to be there.
It's just get a lot more detail there.
That's right.
Then they can do it.
This is the Cliff Notes version. If you want to read the whole novel, you can come on the stage.
I don't think I can stand any more details.
You'd be surprised.
No, I don't think I can.
Yes, and also,
I don't need to. That's the reason we hired you.
Well, I appreciate that.
They have cookies, Margaret.
They have? Yeah. And the one other thing I will add is Mike or some others that have been there, it does also allow you, we do have a wide variety of technical people there, and it does allow you to hear some of their feedback as well that maybe, you know, a different perspective. So.
I do not name that. That's where you went to school to learn.
Is that going to be here? I need to confirm. It's usually at the police headquarters, community room. But
are we going to have it like in the afternoon?
Yes, it's from 2 to 5.
Oh.
1 to 5.
2 to 5.
Yes. It's a 3 to 4 hour session. It's
2 to 5, 1 to 5?
Either one, I'm not sure. 1 or 2 to 5.
1 to 5.
Okay. But you'll have plenty of time. October the 26th, you'll have plenty of time to get the time to
us. Right. And I'll send that
detail
along.
I don't necessarily need right now. So.
Well, thank y'all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, as usual, if y'all have questions or want to discuss further, we'll be happy to do that. So.
Good job. Thank you. Thanks for moving on to consideration of resolution 2011-40, resolution to adopt fire service automated gate agreement between the City of Franklin and Williamson County Rescue Squad.
I think Deputy Chief Culberson, Assistant Chief Horton are coming up to join us on this. This is a...
I do not have an hour.
That was exciting stuff.
These fire guys brought what?
We could tell how excited you were over that watching you.
This is really a sort of a short-term automatic aid agreement for some areas in our urban growth boundary and some mutual benefit that we can achieve from it. I'll let Todd kind of take you through it, and we'd be glad to answer some questions.
Basically, in a nutshell, this Williamson County Rescue Squad protects four different areas of this county: Thompson Station, Hillsborough, Grassland, and also some area that immediately adjoins the city limits, also in our UTV. As the last page of your proposed automatic aid agreement shows a map of the affected area that we're talking about. And this area is a hatched pattern that is located on the far east of our city limits. The Williamson County Rescue Squad is having to relocate from its present building just because of deteriorating conditions there. And it leaves this particular area outside of 5 miles of their fire stations, which has drastically increased the property owner's insurance ratings. Now, up to this point, the insurance companies have thought that they were already in the city limits and they've been meriting reduced rates all along. But through some reappropriations...
Wonder how they thought that.
Through a lot of course, the economy has forced the insurance companies to relook at all properties. And so they've discovered that these properties are not actually inside the city limits and has, in some cases, dropped their insurance altogether. And in other cases, have raised them to a Class 10 rating. One homeowner spoke of having his insurance increased $2,800 a year as a result of this change. So what we hope to do tonight and what we're asking is to achieve one of three goals. And the first one is to buy some time to allow the county to make better plans to provide fire protection to this area. And I will tell you that as of yesterday, the hospital has agreed tentatively, it's yet to be formalized, but should be done hopefully this coming week, to put one of the squad's fire trucks at the hospital. If they do that, then that will satisfy the fire 5 mile for this whole area. And our assistance will not need to be critical at that point. So that's the first objective. The second goal that we would like to accomplish, if that one doesn't pan out, is to at least buy the homeowners a little bit of time to adjust their financial situation to this sudden increase in their cost. The third goal then would be to allow the city the option to study, an in-depth study to determine the benefits of annexation of this area, either in part or in whole, to see if it might benefit the city to have these properties inside the city limits, and then of course the homeowners, what they would merit out of that. So we're simply asking tonight for a six-month agreement to allow these processes to take place, and then with the option to renew at 6 months should any of these not come to fruition, or the board maybe want more information or more time to consider providing service to this area.
A couple points to just touch on. This is for fire suppression services only. This does not deal with emergency medical services, just the fire services. And the reality is we are responsible for mutual aid services to these areas anyway. The automatic aid really just facilitates quicker notice and response on our part. And again, as Todd referenced, this is something long-term you'd want to look at the potential of annexation of some part or whole of this is worthy of further study. This would only be sort of a temporary condition to help through this, these adjustments that are going on with the relocation of the rescue squad and some of the other planning that's going on with the situation.
So where's the rescue squad going?
The permanent home is yet to be determined. We're working on some county property that we believe we're going to be able to relocate to out in the 96 West corridor area. Just to expound on what Eric said, not only is this only a fire, it is only structure fires. And it only involves one engine company and one truck company and then the shift commander from our district. And to give you some idea, we ran numbers for the last 6 years for this particular area, and the squad averages 2 house fires a year in this area. So the commitment level would be extremely low on our part. Now, I didn't mention, but it is in your letter, that in turn, the city would benefit some reciprocating services from the rescue squad. We have the West Haven area, which obviously is a very dense area that has large homes, unprotected, and we would receive mutual aid automatically from the rescue squad for manpower and resources in that area.
By unprotected, you mean they do not have in-home sprinklers?
Residential sprinkler systems.
That's what you paid.
Keep those cards away.
Wait a minute, Paul's got a question.
No, I'm just trying to make sure, because you were saying no financial impact from the city, but we will be receiving a reciprocal...
Reciprocal services.
Services.
For that area, and also for the Goose Creek area.
Goose Creek, yeah.
That's correct.
All right, so they will help us with West Haven and Goose Creek, and we'll help them with what?
With this area that's...
The eastern border of the city, essentially.
All that.
Ms. Butler, it's in the Cedar Mont area, down Arnold Road area, Barrington area on 96.
So again, for the viewers, the difference in automatic aid versus mutual aid. Can y'all go over that one more time?
Automatic aid, both departments are simultaneously dispatched. Mutual aid usually occurs, you get on the scene, figure out you need help, then you call. Automatic, both same time.
Everybody good?
And this would all be automatic. And this is only for 6 months?
This is a six-month initial, and a mutual agreement to do an additional 6 months if we need it.
I do have one question. Of course, there's some other issues here that we're going to take up another time, but that's not for discussion tonight. But I do have one question. So if we do this six-month deal, are they going to be getting any reprieve from their insurance companies? Because the insurance company is going to look at that and go, well, that's only 6 months. Will they go ahead and alleviate some of these homeowners for 6 months, or they're just going to say, oh, that's a temp fix?
No, it is our understanding that the insurance rating would take effect for as long as they have this coverage. And again, if the hospital does finalize the approval of the squad moving, then that will be a permanent long-term situation anyway.
I spoke with a gentleman the other day, and Chief Orton's been fielding calls. Just to give you some idea, I spoke with a gentleman the other day for an hour. His homeowners went from $1,800 to $5,800.
Wow. Yeah.
And there's been a number of folks in Cedar Mont that's been canceled.
But our taxpayer here in Franklin pays city property tax in order to have that coverage.
That's correct.
That's why we would only consider this as a temporary option to just sort of help through this transition. Long-term, you need to look at other resolutions, be it on the county side or joining the city.
And you're saying that actually it's been about two per year, is that right?
Two per year in that area from the squad's records,
right.
That's correct.
Yep.
And this, of course, you know that the fire stations in Goose Creek and West Haven have obviously been delayed through the years because of the financial situation. So this gives us a little bit of opportunity to provide some added protection to that area in this same interim process.
Okay, number eight, consideration of the agreement between the city and the Harpeth River Watershed Association for restoration of a portion of the Harpeth River in the general area of River Mile 88.9.
Okay. We do have a slight update to this agreement. There was just a phrase that was left off that I added in number seven. It's underlined on the front page, and then the back page has the addition. It just allows to incorporate reporting and project management costs, which is again the whole idea of including eligible costs in this. And I can go over that in a minute. The big picture with this is the Lowhead Dam removal project we referred to a little bit earlier that has been being worked on. And one of the things we talked to you about in the earlier in the summer was the opportunity to do an agreement with the Harpeth River Watershed Association to facilitate this project, basically tap into a $350,000 grant from the federal government, from the U.S. Department of Interior Fish and Wildlife Service, also working to leverage investment by Tennessee Department of Environment and Conservation for the actual removal of the dam, which is a value of somewhere around $200,000. And then the city essentially working with our partners to take on the rest of those costs, either directly or through in-kind and other services. This is the removal of the dam is an element of our water withdrawal permit, and the fact that its removal, if feasible, is something we were required to explore. A 2008 study showed that it was feasible under certain conditions to do that. From there, we've moved forward, and this is an opportunity that was brought to us. We've explored over the last year or so, done some additional design work to get us to this point. This agreement was brought to you in July. We've done additional work with the granting agency, with our with Harpeth River Watershed Association to get through to the point that we've got a finalized agreement here. I would also add we've now, in the last couple weeks, received a draft of an agreement with TDEC for their component of this as well. So that's going to shortly follow this as well to cover that element of this project. The item I would highlight for you is the item we had the added phrase to, which is item 7. And that really gets to the fact that, you know, you're still in the midst of your integrated water resource plan. You're still working to make a final decision about the withdrawal of water with the various impacts of this. So there is, we know, some further decisions that the board will make. There's a potential you could, you know, still make a decision to go in some different direction, but there are costs associated that have already been expended from this grant that we would ultimately take responsibility for. To this point, about 120,000, rounding off numbers, have been spent on design and other work to get us to this point. There's a next phase that's necessary to keep us going, to finish the design, to get through permitting, to really get us ready to bid this in the first part of next calendar year, and that's probably another $50,000. So we would spend about up to $170,000 to get to that point, which is where you probably need to, you'll get to match the parallel decision making that's happening in the integrated water plan, but that's likely our exposure if you do this agreement as we've got it drafted here. All, you know, what we've needed to do, I think, to get us to this point so that we could move forward a project that helps us address our permit requirements, helps us address the ecology of the river itself, the quality of the river itself, and helps address the usability, the access to that river overall in terms of what happens for the public as well.
One important thing I think is for us to remember that this study in 2008 showed that it would cost $280,000 just to remove the dam. This doesn't do any reworking of the riverbank or repairing the bank from there. So we're getting all this additional work for additional $13,000. And also, we're about to ask for some more permits for other things from TDEC. This has been a high priority for TDEC for years because it would be nice for us to be on the good side of TDEC. So.
We're not. That's a revelation.
We're on the good side.
All right, everybody good with that? Yeah. All right, we'll move on then.
And this is on the meeting tonight as well.
Yeah.
All right. And that's it.
Do a capital improvement project.
Okay. Thanks
for And let me just frame that what we want to do with this tonight. We're not asking for any decisions. We just want to introduce for you how we've broken out the different options and components of this. So this has been what we've had some discussion about, and what we took from the last discussion is come up with phasing options, come up with ways to look at maybe basic components of roadways that make sense to do as a first phase, both in terms of how far the road goes, but what we develop, whether we do four lanes or two lanes, and what other elements go with that roadway project. So what we've done is gone through updated costs, looked at different mixes of projects from the discussion we've had to this point within the various priorities that have happened, and updated some phasing costs as we understand them as well. So I'll let David kind of take you through the projects as we have them.
The first handout I just gave you is the...
That's okay, I've got one too, I didn't have mine.
Is your prioritization that we've already provided to you, except that we did do some updates on some of the costs. We've spent quite a bit of time recently, engineering department, looking at cost, trying to get them broken down to a more accurate number based on TDOT unit cost and based on unit cost that we've realized when we've had projects such as McEwen Phase 3. So we wanted to get that back out to you where you saw what you have already accomplished as far as prioritization. The second handout that I passed out is eight scenarios of how we could look at funding. The first scenario is the top three prioritized projects from the list that you prioritized. I will tell you that your top priority was Eastern Flank Battlefield Park Access Road. That is already funded, actually. As soon as we get all the paperwork and everything done from TDOT for the grant, et cetera.
Well, we've got to make sure that...
But there is still some other work, additional work later, but that's in there. The second scenario, excuse me, is on that first scenario, we went on and did South Carruthers as the project is laid out, but only with two lanes.
Yep.
And then on McEwen Phase 4, we've done the project as it's laid out, full project again for only two lanes. We knew you didn't want to look at four lanes for either because it's way too expensive. Scenario.
But you did extend it east of Wilson.
No, that's we also.
That's 43.
We included in there the east of Wilson Pike at two lanes. If you remember before, we were talking about that. We're trying to get it to where we can at least get the design for that set up.
Do we not have an agreement with Brentwood?
Yes, we do.
It's already been changed.
Yes, we do.
And, well, let me ask the question then. Do we not have an agreement with Brentwood, and what are we in that position then? And were we not, when we collected 50% or half of the impact fees, and we were supposed to start on that? Go ahead.
We do have an agreement. We did make the change. We have to have the McEwen Drive east of Wilson Pike completed within 24 months after we have received 50% of the funding of the project through the impact fees from the developments in that area. That's the kicker. So what we, this staff, have been trying to look at doing is let's keep that project as far as design, et cetera,
right,
in mill, where we can have the design, where we're ready to kick off and do something as soon as we can. So that's what we're looking at doing. One thing I do want to point out to you on that particular project, we have had to bump the project of about a little over $2 million due to the Columbia Gulf gas line. We had an agreement previously where we were not going to have to relocate it, but they would not allow us to enter into that agreement for a long period of time, a long term, in other words, over 6 to 8 months, if we weren't starting the project. So there is the possibility that we're going to have to relocate or beef up their lines when we come back through. We don't expect that to have to happen, but we have to include some cost in the project, and it's going to cost about $2 million.
That's a $2 million swing.
So we have included that monies in here where we're not surprised later should that be an actuality. So anyway, that has created a little jump in.
Is that going to be included in the 50% of the road impact fees?
We will have to include, if we know for sure that or if we don't know, we'll have to include it because that'll be a cost. If we know for sure that it's not going to be included, of course it would lessen that. But we'll be in discussions with with Columbia Gulf as we're finishing up the final design process, et cetera.
Let me ask you, are the impact fees, the road impact fees from these developments out here going to pay for this, or are we going to have to pay extra money beyond the road impact fees that are that are produced by these developments?
Well, that is something that we're still looking at as far as staff.
Well, we certainly need to look at that.
As far as what the agreement and how we apply the agreement the way it's written. We have our own impact fees. The agreement says prorated share based on a certain way of looking at that prorated share. I have talked, I've been in discussions with Mr. Stuckey and with Shauna Billings, the legal attorney, to see if we can determine how that's actually going to be calculated. But
no, we need to look at that.
To answer your question, I really don't know. Well, I don't know how to answer your question because we don't know what the developments are going to be built as yet. We don't know the density, we don't know the number of lots, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a hard thing to answer, but I kind of doubt that they'll pay 50% more than 50%.
So does the cost of the gas line, is Brentwood also involved with this cost?
No.
It's just us?
The cost of this road is us entirely.
I want to go back to one thing you said. Are you saying that you think that the...
I don't think that the impact fees will pay for the whole road. No, I do not believe they will. I may be wrong, but I do not believe they will.
Well, can we start earlier so we don't have to miss the deadline with...
Well, but wait, then we don't want the road out to nowhere.
There is no deadline.
There is no deadline.
We negotiated the agreement to be driven by development and the generation of impact fees essentially to help pay for at least half of the road.
Okay.
That's what kicks in that we have to have the project started.
But you said something about 8 or 9 months and they were not willing to wait.
That was for a permit. That was we had the preliminary design. We were ready to go and start the permitting with Columbia Gulf. And then, of course, that's when the economy went.
By advancing the design, though, as David's talking about, that will help us potentially resolve this issue.
That's correct.
And there's no need for that road right now.
Well, I don't know whether I'm not going to argue whether we need the road or not, but at some point in time, we have to build it. If there is a potential for the delay to be a $2 million expense on relocating Gulf gas lines. So, yeah, all I'm saying is that we need to keep that in mind, and when that drops down to 43rd on the list or something other, it could be a very expensive project, more so than what it is now if we go ahead and look at something and keep that, and at least keep the design going and make sure that we understand that has a potential for being, and it will be. There's not a potential. The longer we delay on that, the more deterioration those Gulf gas lines will go into, and the more it's going to cost us to go back and replace and or relocate.
It has not been designed, correct?
Preliminary design.
But we can't push that because, you know, that's not the government's, we're not driving that. It's there, it's open land, it's going to stay that way until some developer comes in and says, I want to develop it. That could be a year from now, it could be 10 years from now. We don't know that. And we're not certainly going to be out there pushing to develop that area. That's east of Wilson Pike. My opinion should never have been annexed in the first place. But it's there.
But it is there.
Yes. Yeah,
and
there.
It is ours.
And we have this agreement, and so that's what we're advocating for, is that let at least do the design so that we're ready should develop that agreement.
And you'll see that we've included that in all the scenarios. So scenario two is, again, the top three of your priorities, and it is phasing then the South Carruthers Parkway and McEwen Phase 4. South Carruthers, we have two ways of phasing that. One, in scenario two, is building the Nickel Bend, which is from Falcon Creek down to connector of existing South Carruthers. And then McEwen Phase 4 is providing that temporary connector road. Then scenario 3 is the same as scenario 2, except it reverses South Carruthers and it would be looking at doing South Carruthers across Ladd, across the river, back up to the connector road.
So you're going north instead of south.
Correct.
Right?
And then you do the Nickel Bend at a later time. Scenario 4 is looking at the top five prioritized projects. And again, as I said, every scenario is including the McEwen Drive east of Wilson Pike. What this does is adds Fire Station 8 and 7 as far as the design, but we only have in construction for Fire Station 8, which is the West Haven Fire Station. And then also adding to the listing Central Court Beasley Drive connector. That would round out your top five. Scenario 5 is just like Scenario 2, except it's for the top five. That has Nickel Bend, South Carruthers being built first, and then Ladd later. Scenario 6 has reversed then. It's, again, it's top five, but it has Ladd Park section of South Carruthers first, and then Nickel Bend later. Scenario 7 gets back to what staff recommended to you back in April. We went in and we did some revisions on numbers as far as estimates and looking at just building some of the two-lane sections versus four-lane sections. I will tell you that the South Carruthers is a little bit of a skewed number. What we had, and we concentrated so much and we ran out of time that we have an old number there for the full two lanes. So that is a little bit wrong. That
one it's last a thing. Bit what?
It's wrong as far as the final number. If you compare it, the cost for this for the whole section is the same as the cost for doing the Ladd Park section. If we split it up, so we know that's wrong, and we just didn't get that corrected. Now I do want to tell you, when we go to these phasings, and there will be some premium cost. I mean, in other words, you can't just add together what the length would be, because you're going to have premium costs in the fact that you've got to make tie-ins, you got double mobilization, you've got additional costs because you're going to phase it. Should not be the kind of cost we see here, though. But there will be additional costs when we go to phase, and it's not going to be a tremendous amount, but there will be some. McEwen Phase 4, more so than South Carruthers, because Phase 4, the connector, some of that we would be building for that connector when we go back and just do the two lanes that would go from Cool Springs all the way out to Wilson Pike, we have to tear up a section of that. So it's some of that is actually going to be a throwaway when we just do the connector. But again, it's not a tremendous amount of money, but we get the connector would be an improvement that would greatly benefit that area out there. So, and then Scenario 8, about to run out of steam. What we did on Scenario 8 is we took the staff recommendation and then we added Carlisle Lane, Boyd Mill Avenue intersection signalization and improvement. So this is just adding that one project to Scenario 7. So I wanted to explain what those are. If you have any questions, feel free to call us. And of course, as Mr. Stuke said, we're not looking for any kind of decision right now, but we wanted to get this information to you. You told us you wanted us to look at some phasing options, and this is what we've come up with, and I guess there's other ways you could look at doing these, but I don't know where we're going from here.
Let's don't forget the page of the thing that was owed for us, that what we're kind of committed to from the previous approved projects, mm-hmm. what we would be having to spend in 2012 and 2013 in addition to these numbers that we see here.
Well, Mr. Truel will be taking the scenarios and we'll be looking at getting
we're working with PFM to do the analysis in terms of the funding model on these various scenarios. Just wanted to really bring these back to you, explain where we were with the update costs, also get a sense from you if there was something we were missing here in terms of a mix of projects. We kind of heard do a mix of some of the top priorities with some phasing options and see how those look. And that's what we've tried to do here. We don't know how the financing model is going to shake out with all these, but that would be our next step.
So in October, if the 84 lumber situation becomes available again, then we would
Yeah, and that's still included in the staff recommended package.
That's on 7 or 8.
Option 7 and 8, it includes that. So we still are kind of tracking that, and that's still an option to consider.
All right. Let's move on then. Number 10, consideration ordinance 2010-48 to be entitled an ordinance to add section 5.8.5 to chapter 5, section 5.8 of the City of Franklin zoning ordinance to regulate development within the corporate limits of Franklin, Tennessee to minimize danger to life and property due to flooding and to maintain eligibility for participating in the National Flood Insurance Program. Are there any questions?
These are, well, yeah.
Very briefly, this is
I thought that was the state.
That was very good, by the way.
This is the state model. It does not affect uses within the zoning ordinance at all. It is simply the standards for construction. The next three ordinances are those standard for constructions. The only caveat is that the City of Franklin is looking at a more stringent standard for building up properties. The state requires 1 foot. We are asking, Plan Commission is asking for a 3 foot base elevation. Nashville is at 4 feet. And all three of the next ones are either definitions attached to the state model or other information attached to the state model.
Everybody good with 11 and 12?
Sure.
Yes.
Number 13, discussion of contract with Equitality to place up to 2 charging stations each in the 2nd and 4th Avenue garages and pursue another 2 charging stations for Jim Warren Park.
And staff has been working on this diligently for a while now with Equitality. We did get a contract from them. That contract had to be revised slightly. We're bringing this information back to you. Kristen Korn with our legal department has been working on this as well to make sure that the city is protected and everything it needs to do. We believe that Brentwood last night just passed their contract. Chattanooga, Nashville, Knoxville, many of the other cities, Murfreesboro, many of the other cities are already participating in the program. Andrew worked very hard to put together about a 10-minute slide presentation or PowerPoint presentation for you, which we probably won't get to given the time limit.
Bypass that.
Yes.
Is there anything you want to highlight in particular?
The 30-minute elevator pitch is simply this. There are 7 states participating in the EV project. Tennessee is one of them. The project's rolling along. There are about 1,200 level 2 electric vehicle charging stations available in Tennessee. We can claim a couple of those for the downtown garages. The city would not outlay any funds for this. Once Equitality establishes a revenue model, the city would actually stand to earn a little income on the revenue coming in.
And again, we're looking at 2 charging stations each in each of the downtown parking garages. That's really what we have the contract for at this point. We would also be interested, if the opportunity presents itself, to pursue charging stations at Jim Warren Park as another option to look at a park location. So that's just something else that that if that comes up, we basically use the same contract for that location.
Right. How did the users pay for their?
That's yet to be determined. They're probably going to experiment with a few different models. So it would be a swipe card.
Oh,
okay. So swipe your credit card.
Go ahead,
too.
Thank
you. Oh, sorry. Okay. The issue here is I'm wanting to know why. Well, first of all, back in here it says the license agreement expires and it terminates on April 30th, 2013. And then we take this over.
Yes.
And then we own this. Mm-hmm. Then we're responsible to maintain it. We're responsible to take it out and put it back in if it needs to be replaced. I want to know what the scenarios are on those costs. And I want to know why government's doing this. Because we have private sectors doing this already. And we have, I've been trying to read about this enough.
I'll speak to that.
Well, trying to read about this enough to know, and I just brought one example where this is going back 15 years, and California is known for using, being, you know, environmentally friendly on a lot of things, forerunner on certain things, and Costco has had these things, and they're finding out that they're either not being used or they're having to be replaced, and in this little scenario here, they said, a manager said he hasn't seen anyone use the EV chargers in a full year. They're taking them out. They had 6 chargers. 1 person plugged in once a week. Chargers are very inefficient and not productive for the retailer. We have 5 million members in this region and just a handful of people using the devices. Some Costco charges around Los Angeles stopped working years ago, and of course, some of those were outdated. No, we have new technology and some things, so that's sort of a wash there, you could possibly say. But they've supported, they're not supporting a program to upgrade them, and they've decided not to participate in the state program as of this year. And they said, why should we have anybody spend money on a program that nobody's thought through here? And they said it is, and that may not be such a fair comment, because there's probably a lot of technology and a lot of research going on here. So I take that with a grain of salt, but this is so new that I say, anyway, they said we'll be taking them out in California. So, and then they're happening around the different places too that they're not getting used. So my question is, I'm not opposed to them, I'm just saying, why is government getting involved? Let them put it in. Let them pay us a charge to have them and maintain them in our garages, and let them have us realize that 33% profit, and let them take it. Why should we be involved in doing this? Private sectors around the city, the state, they're getting involved in this. Let the private sector do it, and let the government just say, hey, run a space in our garage.
Alderman Skinner. Oh, I'm sorry. You want to respond?
You bring up a lot of valid points. The intent, the purpose of the EV project is to determine how these chargers are used and how people are using their vehicles. Out of the 1,200 vehicle chargers available in the state of Tennessee, about 10% of them are for municipal governments, local governments, put at their libraries or city halls, their parks. The rest of the 80 to 90% that's remaining goes to restaurants, shops, businesses, tourist destinations, institutions. So they really want a sprinkling of charging stations so we can really kind of figure out how they're going to be used for the next wave of EVs that come out. Nearly every major car company has an EV somewhere in the development process. I don't think that Nissan would have invested $1.7 billion in Smyrna if they didn't think that there is a future in this. And as far as
the other thing I just add is it's an opportunity for us to get it provided as one of these many different locations, public and private. So we get the capital at no cost to us, and then there's an opportunity to decide how to maintain it beyond that.
But this
is an opportunity to provide it to our citizens in a heavily used area in our downtown, and just another extension of providing more options for more people who choose to come and visit and be part of our community.
And they're not willing to put it in and maintain it.
They're willing to put it in and maintain it the startup period.
Yeah, and maintain it till April of 2000.
No, they're not willing to maintain it after that time.
After that time.
They want us to own it and maintain it.
It becomes ours.
Yes, and at that time, we've talked to Brad Wilson, we've talked to many of our people, and they have indicated that they don't think that this is a big maintenance problem. If it becomes a big maintenance problem, taking it out is an option, but right now.
You won't kick it out, Catherine.
No, we won't.
Put it in.
No.
People getting used to you.
And because it is a benefit, we will then be able to decide what we're going to charge for
I'm not trying to really argue against it as much as I want it all out on the table, because I want to make the best decision. And I've got people calling me, telling me not to vote for it because they don't think government should be in the electrical vehicle charging business. And I happen to agree with them in some ways. But I want to say that, and I know we've got to get going here,
but 30 more seconds, and I just think that
we need to talk about this. And all due respect to Brad, who I dearly love and think does a great job, but if I don't think that it's going to cost, I don't want somebody to tell me I don't think it's going to cost. I want some hard facts before I can vote to say what is it going to be and our responsibility. Because we've been down that road before, and I've voted before for things, and I go, okay, wish I knew those facts before I had voted on it.
Alderman Skinner. That was 28 seconds.
I'll be reading her final two.
Ding, ding.
They are giving us these machines. They are giving us the machine. You can't imagine that the replacement for any parts of this is going to be more than what the cost of the machine is. Number two, this is the national headquarters for Nissan, who is the first company to nationally market an all-electric car. We need to support our businesses and companies that are here. We need to be proud to participate in electric charging.
I agree, but that's not the point.
All right, we're going to consider 14, 15, and 16 together. They're just a renewal of some emergency grant funds. So are there any questions? If not, we'll resume. And what do you want, 10 minutes?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, 10 after 7.